Yeah. incredibly parochial and untraveled alleged internationalist. I, from the earliest age, knew how rare America was. And I don't know why I did, and vast numbers of my peers didn't, spelled America with a K, as if we were a fascist country. We do not know what fascism is. And I realized something. They really don't know what evil is.
There is perhaps no more fearful idea in the history of magic and religion than possession. The very notion that our bodies could be inhabited by supernatural evil, which twists our very being into a very caricature of itself, is positively dread-inducing. Regardless of the spiritual cloak and dagger business and all this, you'll notice what's interesting about both these stories. In both of these accounts, the evil spirit is actually sent by God. It doesn't seem to have a kind of independent existence all its own. What we don't seem to see here is the kind of independent or semi-independent demonic world where spiritual entities are targeting human beings and possessing them. Rather, they're being sent by the Israelite God to accomplish a very specific goal and the overall agenda of that God. This likely represents the theological concerns of the writers of these texts. In these texts, one simply has to imagine that God has complete executive power over how things go in the world. There's simply very little theological room for an independent demonic executive power to. This writer very strongly on the monotheistic scale of things. And we see that exact kind of theological idea echoed in so-called Third Isaiah, where the Israelite God declares, Ani tol v'ra, Ani or v'choshech, I am the light, I am the dark, I am the good, and I am the evil. This is an idea of radical monotheism. Even evil in this strata of Israelite theology is attributed directly to the Israelite God. There's simply no notion of independent evil found in the darkness. Summarize, at least in a very brief way, the exorcistic healing processes and rituals of the Eshugu or the incantation experts as described in the 16 Neo-Assyrian tablets. The basic task of the exorcistic ritual here was to transfer the demon or ghost away from the affected person or place such that it could be sort of peeled off or dusted away in a way that it could be otherwise dispatched from that person. The idea here is to transfer it from one entity to another and then remove that entity, the demon or the ghost, into another place. Typically, there's no sense that you can actually destroy the demon or the ghost. It's simply either move them to a different location, trap them, or perhaps get them to go safely into the underworld. Some of these Mesopotamian exorcistic concepts actually do make their way into Israelite religion, although somewhat indirectly. Of course, the most obvious is the idea of the Azazel goat. This is a ritual in which the high priest of ancient Israel would actually transfer the sins of the Israelite people on Yom Kippur into a goat, and this goat would be dispatched into the wilderness. There are some stories in which it's actually thrown down a mountain. But the idea here of transferring sin or evil or infection to an animal and then killing that animal, we find it, of course, in ancient Mesopotamia, but we see it also here being incorporated at some level into ancient Israelite religious practice as well. The other important concept that you may have noticed is the idea that places can be infected with demonic power as well. This is very lightly echoed in the ancient Israelite conception of Sa'arat. which is sometimes translated incorrectly as leprosy. This is not Hansen's disease. It's Arat, it's some kind of supernatural illness sent directly from God, and importantly, it can inflict people, famously inflicted Moses' sister Miriam, but it can also inflict places, and there are very complicated rituals in which Arat can be diagnosed by priests and can be dispatched by them and by them alone. So in both of these cases, both the case of the Azazel goat and the concept of Sa'arat, the supernatural elements which can afflict both people and places, we have something like ancient Near Eastern possession and exorcism rituals being imported into Israelite religion. Spirits coming from God and possessing people to make them do things, but we also have the exorcistic technology being imported from ancient Mesopotamian cultures in the form of the Azazel goat and its Arat illness. Possession and exorcism as we know it in both Israelite religion and in turn in Judaism. The next major moment in this history is the Babylonian exile, which began in 586 BCE and the rise of Jewish apocalypticism. Possession and exorcism by Osterreich remains basically the most important touchstone in the field. Although there are sections that significantly need updating, it's still pretty reliable. And if you're interested in the cultural, spiritual, and religious dimensions of the concepts of possession and exorcism, that's where I'd start. That he does, I would certainly go look up the modern contemporary scholarship on what's going on in exorcism and possession in those specific cases. For instance, we know a ton more about exorcism and possession in the ancient Near East world and the ancient Egyptian world than he did when he wrote that book. So those sections specifically are quite thin. So again, I would really recommend checking his work against more contemporary scholarship, but it's certainly a great place to start. Gospels. maker of the famous Jewish used very likely in exorcism rituals, we don't have in the Dead Sea Scrolls. While we do have these exorcistic scrolls, they do give us some insight into the theology and the practice of exorcism as it was done in the age of the first century of the Common Era, what is actually missing are the actual rituals that they may have done to further the process of exorcism itself. In other words, what we don't know is how do these texts actually function into the practice of exorcism as a ritual. Were there fumigations? Were there unguents? Did they use ritual baptism? That was a core component of life there at Qumran and in Yachad. The answer is we don't know. What we have here are the texts, but we don't have anything like the rituals that these texts would have focused into. While we have the text or the incantations that would have been used very likely in exorcism rituals, we don't have any sense of what would have been done in addition to the chanting perhaps of these texts. Precisely in graveyards and tombs that demons seem to lurk most ferociously. We're told further that this man is possessed by a demon or demons, and that this demonic possession has given him unusual strength. Apparently, the townspeople have tried to bind him with ropes and chains, and he has subsequently broken them now. Upon just the sight of Jesus, the demons themselves seem to recognize his immense power and beg not to be tortured. At this point, Jesus commands the demons to come out of this man and then demands to further know what their name is. This idea of knowing what the name of a demon is in order to control it is a classic idea that we found all the way back in ancient Egypt, and this idea will be found all the way until ritual practice of the contemporary period. Upon that command, the demon reveals its name. In fact, we find out that it's not just one demon. It is, in fact, a host of demons, and these demons reveal their name to the Legion. We'll come back to that in just a moment. The demons then beg Jesus not to simply cast them out, but specifically to cast them out into something else. In this case, a herd of pigs, which once Jesus does cast them out into this unclean animal, right? This is very important. The image of the pig, of course, would have been seen as a deeply unclean animal in the Jewish imagination, and casting out the unclean demon unto an unclean animal makes sense. This also harkens back to the older Mesopotamian idea that one can transfer the demon from an afflicted person over to a different animal. Back then, it was a goat, but in this story here, we have them cast into pigs. Subsequently, the herd of pigs, now filled with these demon legion, throw themselves off a cliff into some water and therefore die. It's important to note that the local townspeople, while impressed and somewhat terrified of Jesus' power to move these demons into these pigs, are also equally terrified of Jesus and basically request that he leave and go somewhere else. While the possessed man, who wants to join with Jesus as Jesus departs, is actually told to go to the Decapolis and simply tell people what has happened to him, thus further spreading the message of Jesus and the idea of Jesus' enormous power over the forces of evil.
Basically, basically figured out a way to create this online utopian world where you cannot express your dissatisfaction with the government or with the prevailing systems of what's happening. That will be America. Eventually, they're going to figure out a way to get there, but it's always going to feel so much cooler than China because we're going to have the best entertainment, or very good entertainment. Food is going to come right to your door. Amazon drones are going to drop off your groceries. But the flip side is you're not going. You'll be just crushing under the weight of the empire. But that's okay. Yeah, I mean, that's okay. Like, people get mad at me. They're like, no. I'm like, what are you going to do?
Right.
What's the other plan?
Right. And
this is the plan.
This is your plan.
You're going to be crushed under the weight of a technocracy. Get on board or you're in trouble. I'm okay with it. I kind of want it. Like, I'm kind of ready for it in a way that I'm stunned how ready for it I am. Yeah, I'm kind of ready to go and turn my door to leave and have it go. Air quality level's not sufficient. I'm like, all right, I've been here 3 months. I guess they'll let me out one day, but who goes? Oh, is there food here?
Yeah, it's all
good.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm in the quadrant with food.
Yeah.
Good.
Good.
Oh, we have a new movie.
There's a DXL.
We got a new movie. We got a DXL. I have a new shirt. I have a new polo I can wear.
Drops it in the house.
Yeah, it's coming. And people that want to fight, you can smash as many Starbucks windows in Seattle as you like.
Yeah.
It ain't going to change anything. And the world those people want isn't going to be great either. But yeah, and by the way, I could be wrong about all this, but I don't think I am. I think that's kind of going to be, and I don't think they'll even have to lock the door. I think it'll be voluntary. I think people just keep like, yeah, I don't want to leave and get the ember in my throat today.
Yeah.
So I'll just stay inside.
I do think you're totally right.